Okay, we are now recording.
Hi, everyone. Thank you guys so much for joining us tonight. We are really looking forward to tonight's episode, Advocating for Change, NAAF's Legislative Liaison Program. For most of you, you know who I am. I'm Dr. Thomason. I co-host this webinar with my wonderful colleague, Dr. Angela Rogers. We have been doing this webinar series since September of 2020. Just me and her needed some way to advocate for our community. Angela and I are very passionate about the psychological aspects of the alopecia community, and we wanted to provide an outlet for people with alopecia. Just let's talk about different things that most platforms don't talk about, and NAAF provided that space for us. And so we've been really excited, been really blessed over the past several months, and I really feel like we've made a difference in our community. Tonight's episode is really kind of special. We're learning more about the, how can I put this, the legislative aspect about how we can communicate what we need for our community. NAAF has a really great legislative liaison program, and so we're going to be hearing more from Gary Sherwood about that. And so I'm getting excited about tonight. We will start off with Angela just talking more about the housekeeping aspects, and then we'll get right into it. Angela.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Renee, for introducing me. So as she mentioned, I'm Dr. Angela Rogers, family medicine, and I am one of the hosts and creators of this webinar series, Let's Talk with Dr. Renee Thomason. So yes, tonight's episode is really exciting, but I do have a few things to go over before we actually get into the episode itself. So the first of which is everyone is muted right now, or I have muted you. That was on purpose, just to allow her to be heard without any background noise. We're going to be having a Q&A session towards the end of this episode. And so I will allow you to unmute yourself and to show yourself on video if you would like to ask your question. And so hopefully there are a lot of questions written down and ready to go. The second thing is that this this episode is being recorded, and it's going to be posted on the NAAF YouTube page as well as the Let's Talk webpage, and you can find that on the NAAF website. And we also will be asking our guest speakers and panelists to be placing their contact information in the chat towards the end of this episode, just so if you have any follow-up questions or actually want to become a legislative liaison, which is the goal, that you can get in contact with them to find out more and continue asking your questions and making connections. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and get started with our amazing legislative liaison lead. Dr. Gary Sherwood, you've become a doctor now, honorary doctor.
Your mom will love you for that, Angela. You've made all right. Things come true.
Wonderful. So this is Gary's bio. So Gary Sherwood has been NAAF's communications director since 2012. The same year, he created the Legislative Liaisons Program so alopecia areata patients and their families could not only advocate, but form relationships with the office of their lawmakers. Prior to coming to NAAF, Gary worked in public affairs to State Farm Insurance for 13 years, learning the fine points of legislative advocacy, which he then wanted to share with those who needed a voice. He is exceedingly proud, not only of the accomplishments of the legislative liaisons, but the legislative mentors as well. His favorite NAAF memory was the day in September 2017 when close to 200 legislative liaisons and other community members had the opportunity to meet with the FDA to better inform the administration on what it's like to have the disease of alopecia areata and what they'd like to see in a treatment. I'm very, very excited for Let's Talk to welcome Gary Sherwood, who will then go ahead and introduce the rest of our amazing panel tonight.
Angela, Renee, thank you so much for having me and this whole panel on. You're going to be meeting some of the real cream of our legislative liaison program. You'll also be meeting Phil Gogles from the Health and Medicine Council, who's been extraordinarily useful. for our efforts as well. It's a real honor to be on Let's Talk. This webinar series has done so much for our community, and we're just so excited to be here. I especially am just so grateful for this time to share what we're doing legislatively. I think all of us are very proud of the progress we've made. As you mentioned in my intro, just going to FDA headquarters back in 2017 with close to 200 advocates and community members and getting to speak directly to the FDA, that was a huge accomplishment. That took about 5 years of legislative outreach to accomplish, because the FDA does not just meet with any disease group. There's something, I think, 12,000 known diseases around the world, and the FDA was only going to meet with a couple dozen. So for us to be selected was a real honor, and it took quite a bit of work, but the legislative liaison showed that they were up to the task. And again, that was like really my proudest day, I think, with NAAF, but there have been lots of other days too where I've been so proud of the people who are in this program. Advocacy is so important, and it's empowering as well, not just for the patients, but their families. So again, thank you so much for having us here this evening. I think what I'd like to do then is to introduce Phil. Phil Gugliss has been with the Health and Medicine Council. Phil, I think you can correct me on this now. I think you're going on, what, 7 or 8 years now?
About seven, I think. But honestly, time flies, and last year, you know, kind of is all jumbled into one. But it's a pleasure to be here with everybody. Gary, I'll let you finish your remarks before I jump.
I was just going to remark that Phil is a fixture at our days on Capitol Hill when we get to go to Washington, D.C. Of course, this was, you know, pre-pandemic. We anticipate being able to resume this again post-pandemic. What we do is we like to bring about 30 legislative liaisons and their families to D.C. with us in September during Alopecia Areata Awareness Month. And we have an incredible day on the Hill where we meet with our senators and our congressional representatives. And Phil is instrumental in helping put that together. Phil also meets with us once a month when we have our advocacy committee meetings. The committee is made up of about a dozen of veteran legislative liaisons. And so Phil gives us a briefing directly from Washington, giving us all the latest news about what we can expect moving forward and what's legislation that we should get behind. And then I believe we are later on then going to introduce not just some legislative liaisons, but I believe we've got maybe one or two legislative mentors as well who'll be joining us. These are people under the age of 18 who nevertheless are interested in the legislative process. And so this new program was started for them about a year and a half ago. So we look forward to talking more about that as well. But right now, I think I'll turn things over to Phil, and Phil's going to talk more about what our legislative priorities are. So Phil, take it away.
Thanks, Gary. I'm just going to share my screen here, make sure everybody can see it. Hopefully that is working well for folks. But thank you for having me this evening, afternoon, to be with all of you. As Gary mentioned, I've been working with NAAF and the alopecia community for many years now, and I've had the privilege to meet many of my fellow panelists in person over the years here in Washington, D.C., as we have worked through meeting Capitol Hill and engaging with the federal government. So I just want to be very brief in my remarks. I know it's very dangerous to give anybody from Washington, D.C. a platform to speak endlessly, but I will try to be as brief as possible just to hit some high points and then, you know, look forward to a great conversation. So first, we're just in the first session of the 117th Congress. And with the new Congress, there is a new administration as well. So as a result of the elections last year, there are a lot of new members of the House of Representatives, new members of the Senate, and a new presidential administration that has taken over. So where we are now in terms of our advocacy is a prime time, because there are many new folks who are here in Washington, D.C., which gives us a great opportunity to educate them and raise awareness about not only alopecia areata, but all of our priorities and how they can become champions of our community. Currently, in the month of May, as they have been working on for pretty much the entire spring, is working on budget and appropriations activities. Normally, the administration releases their budget requests at the beginning of February, which includes funding levels or recommendations for federal agencies. Because it's a new administration and because there has been a lot of focus on responding to the COVID pandemic, They have not yet released their full budget. We are still waiting for that. We expect that to happen sometime in May, but we are still active in the appropriations process and advocating for robust funding across key federal agencies that we'll talk about in a little bit. And of course, Congress continues to focus on healthcare policies, which include medical research and patient access. So that's why we continue to engage in our key priorities with Congress. So just a quick review of some of our successes last year. Despite the fact that our large in-person Hill Day, where Gary, I believe we were gonna have about 400 people here in Washington, DC, who were gonna be making visits on Capitol Hill last during the month of June. We had to cancel that, postpone that for last year, but we were able to successfully transition to a virtual Hill engagement. And because of our success, with meeting virtually with offices here in DC and locally, we were able to see some real good movement on some of our key priorities. They include expanding the research portfolio at the National Institutes of Health. There was an increase of funding for NIH. There was some specific alopecia recommendations that were included in the appropriation bills that highlighted the need for more research to be done on alopecia areata. We worked successfully to establish a key relationship with Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley. I always tell folks her office was one of the last in-person meetings I've had on Capitol Hill, and that was way back in February of 2020. So we were able to work with her office as soon as she shared her patient story and what her experience was and continues to be. We quickly developed that relationship with her and her office. She was able to provide a welcome video for our conference. And then during our awareness month in September, she stood on the House floor and took a significant portion of time dedicated to raising awareness on alopecia areata, in addition to sharing her own story. So we have had great success in 2020, despite the virtual component of it, but we look forward to continuing to build off of our recent successes in 2021 and beyond. So again, just some things that are currently happening here in DC. There are a lot of new members of Congress. So of course, that's a dream for, you know, Gary and myself, because it's just a natural opportunity to raise the importance of advocacy, to engage folks and to be able to develop new champions, folks who are new to Washington, who may have never heard of alopecia areata, who don't know anything about it, but because now one of their colleagues is a member of our community, but also the advocates that we have in their districts, we're able to engage with them, let them know what the priorities are, and truly develop them into being champions for us. We have been developing our key priorities, and I will plug our other webinars that, you know, we've recorded in terms of advocacy that I encourage everybody to see, because I think it's very helpful. It goes a little more in depth on some of our priorities, but we also have some key information in there on how to contact your two senators and your member of the House, because I can go into and meet with all Senate offices, which is 100, and all House offices, which is 435. So I can meet every single office and tell them it's important that they support our priorities. The one question I will get from everybody is somebody in my district affected by this? So the key thing is for everybody to develop those relationships and to meet with your local elected members of the House and U.S. senators to share your experience, share their story, and highlight for them why it's important. That's been part of our expansion of advocacy activities. You know, we've been working to ensure that everybody has all of the information that they need and the tools, and I'm sure we'll get into more of how everybody can participate and be active in our advocacy activities. So just a quick background on some of our successes. For in DC, we live with acronyms because, you know, every federal agency is shortened down. So NIH is the National Institutes of Health. They're the ones who are the foremost organization that supports biomedical research. I'm sure many folks have gotten to know Dr. Fauci very well over the past year and change. He is a director at one of the NIH institutes, not one that we work with, but NIH does a lot of critical research, and they're the ones who help us to better understand causes of alopecia, different breakthroughs that can be found. And then we take all of that key discovery and research, and we use that for possible treatments, for other education and awareness activities. So it's critical that NIH remains funded appropriately to ensure that they're able to provide research funding across the board. So NIH is currently funded at $42.9 billion. And of course, the more funding that NIH has overall, the more that we're able to have specifically for alopecia research. As I mentioned in last year's bill, there was specific language that highlighted the need for more research to be done on alopecia areata. And the way that happens is for NIH to receive more funding. So what we're asking for in this year is for NIH to receive $46.1 billion, which is another meaningful increase. And it's an increase that the larger patient community all across the board is supporting. We're also asking for a proportional institute for NIAMS, which is the institute who directly supports alopecia areata research. And there was a specific funding increase for NIAMS in last year's budget that Congresswoman Presley advocated for directly for more alopecia areata research. So all of this doesn't happen in a vacuum. It's because of the relationships that many folks in our community have forged with their members who have gotten them to become dedicated to working with us and helping us to advance, you know, these key priorities. Without the requests and the interaction from their constituents, you know, they wouldn't be taking a leadership on any of these issues. So I know that many of you are aware of the cranial prosthetics legislation that has been introduced previously. Unfortunately, because of the COVID-19 pandemic last year, Congress really didn't do much. Couple that with an election year, and there was really nothing done. Normally, the budget and appropriations are finished well ahead of the end of the fiscal year, which is the end of September, and Congress, you know, is able to move that through the process, and then they get to shift to other bills that are moving through, such as our bill. But last year, they did not finish appropriations until the very end of December. And, you know, Christmas Eve morning, I was writing summary memos because Congress waited till the very end, like sometimes they always do, to finish things off. So there wasn't really any movement in any bills besides the annual must-pass bills from Congress. Pre-COVID, you know, we had developed a good list of co-sponsors who were supportive of our bill. We had good conversations with key committee folks about including this in a larger package. So we were making great progress. And I don't want to overlook the great progress that we were making pre-COVID. What happened during COVID with, you know, the lack of movement was beyond our control. And because it's a new Congress, we're working on reintroducing the bill. So we have yet to do that because we want to make sure that we're being strategic in how we introduce the bill with the new Congress. And as I mentioned, the new administration, you know, they have kind of pushed the budget request down the line many times, and that has prevented a lot of offices from being able to move forward. So we want to make sure that when we do reintroduce the bill, that we have the appropriate amount of co-sponsors. You know, we're able to engage with our community members to ask their folks, their members, to co-sponsor the legislation. And, you know, we are working to get the bill introduced, you know, by this summer. So it is coming, but we are working on it. And there are some other considerations that, you know, we have to take into account before we just introduce a bill to make sure that we're set up for success. But again, last year was the first time also we had a Senate version of the bill. Previous years, we only had a bill introduced on the House side. But last year, we were fortunate enough to work with Senator Blumenthal from Connecticut, who introduced the Senate version of the bill. So we're continuing to make progress on the bill. And of course, everybody will receive more information as we get closer to bill and reintroduction, because we're going to want to have as many folks on as original co-sponsors as we possibly can. So stay tuned for more on that. Of course, education and awareness is very important. And one of the things that we have been advocating for over the past few years, and we were successful with last year, is a new program at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, which supports chronic disease education and awareness. So there are any number of specific programs at CDC that receive funding of $1 million, $7 million, $10 million. And those funds go directly to whatever that line item is. Over the past few years, we've recognized that there's no real opportunity to add a new program. So we try to figure out what is the best mechanism to ensure that we be able to access funds from CDC to work on education and awareness, to make sure that all the science and good work that's being done at NIH, we're able to share with the medical community, we're able to share with the patient community, and we're able to increase our footprint in making sure that folks really understand what alopecia areata is. So this program was funded last year at $1.5 million, which is great to get it off the ground, but we are looking for $5 million, and that's our request for $5 million for fiscal year 2022, because this will give the CDC, of course, more resources to provide grants that will allow communities and organizations like ours to compete for funding and work on critical education and awareness activities. Now, I know people might see this slide and say, wow, that's a lot of words. Don't worry about it. We just wanted to share that we have been very much involved with Safe Step Therapy and Step Therapy Protocol. And the Safe Step Act is another piece of legislation that had previously been introduced, and there was meaningful progress on this in the last Congress, but was unfortunately unable to be moved forward because of the pandemic. And what this bill does in a nutshell is prevent fail-first therapies and to eliminate those fail-first protocols. So if you're a patient and you have already tried a specific therapy and you know that it doesn't work and your doctor knows it doesn't work, your insurance can't say, well, you have to do this, prove that it doesn't work in order to receive the treatment that you know does work. So NAAF has been involved with larger patient community on this issue for the past few years now. And this is something that really points to, we're very active in the here and now and what is affecting our community today. But we're also very much aware of what great things are happening for our community and where some of these issues will be in a year or two. And, you know, we continue to be active on them to make sure that as, you know, more treatments become available, our patients and our community isn't denied access to those treatments. And we want to make sure that everybody is able to, with the advice and with the counsel of their doctors, to be able to maintain that critical access and not have a third party or insurance company say that they have to start kind of back at one and prove that, you know, one, two, or three types of treatments don't work before they get approval for the one that they do know works because they've tried everything else. So you'll see more about this in some of our materials, but of course, what's key and what's number one for us is, you know, the reintroduction of our cranial prosthetics legislation, you know, continuing critical funding for the National Institutes of Health, for the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And, you know, as an organization, we continue to keep our eye out on patient access issues to make sure that things that are debated and decided on now does not adversely affect the alopecia community. That brings me to the end. I think I was as quick as I could possibly be. There's Gary's contact email there, my email address as well. I'll share it towards the end with everybody else, but don't hesitate to let us know if you have any questions. As Gary mentioned, every month I join our advocacy committee, update them on things that are happening here in Washington, discuss, you know, what's coming up on the horizon and how as a community we can make the greatest impact on the decisions that are being made here in Washington. And for those of you who I haven't met, you know, I hope to meet you all next year when the large NAAF Hill Day is back in Washington, D.C. Hopefully we'll be able to shake hands by then and be as back to normal as we possibly can be. But I look forward to seeing all of you and thank you again. Gary, I'll turn it back to you in case I missed anything.
Thanks, Phil. That was a really terrific presentation. Really well done. And I'm really glad, Phil, that you touched upon relationships, because as you know, that's a key component to any advocacy. And that's really why I began the legislative liaison program. Is Angela mentioned in my introduction, I came to NAAF in 2012. NAAF's annual patient conference was in Washington, D.C. that summer. I had been with NAAF for all of about 4 months by that time. It was my first time meeting many of our community members. And we had literally hundreds of legislative meetings set up for that Hill Day. And that was great that we had that, what we called optics, you know, that great moment where you can have like hundreds of people all wearing matching shirts and we all have the photos taken on the Capitol steps. And that was great. But most of the meetings were spent having to tell legislators and staff what alopecia areata is. And so there wasn't a whole lot of time, unfortunately, to get across our asks. And that's because we just didn't have the relationships in place. And so that's why I started legislative liaisons, so we could initiate those relationships and have them in place so that when we do get to go back to Washington, D.C., they already know who we are and they're already familiar with alopecia areata. And we saw that borne out in just a few years where you had President Obama, I believe it was in 2016, mentioned alopecia areata in his budget message to Congress. That was the first time a president ever mentioned alopecia areata. And then, as we mentioned earlier, 2017, we had this very hard to get meeting with the FDA. And that only came about through all of our advocacy and raising our presence on Capitol Hill and building those relationships with our lawmakers. So that's why it's so important that we have this program. And, you know, I tell people when they first come into legislative liaisons, don't worry so much if your congressperson or senator isn't able to back, you know, our bills or do what we're asking. You know, they can only do so much. They've only got, you know, so much bandwidth. And especially if alopecia areata is something new to them, it may not be something they can take on right away. But at least you're building the relationship. And that's really the most important thing you can do. There's no such thing as a bad meeting. As long as you're conveying information to them and as long as they're learning about alopecia areata and what's important to our community, it may not pay off today, but it may very well pay off down the road. So that's, again, why it's so important to build those relationships. And I know, like, when Phil was going into these issues, it might have looked like a lot, especially if this is something that is new to you. But I can tell you this, when you go into those meetings, the best thing you can do is just talk about the issues that are important to you. Don't feel you have to memorize everything that we're sending you. You know, what we give you is a prep packet, and we also give you a leave behind packet. And the reason we give you the leave behind packet is so you can leave that behind with whoever you're meeting with at that office, be it your lawmakers or their staff. And they can then go through that at their leisure. And they can go through those issues in greater detail. And that way you can really just focus on the issues that are central to you. You know, your meeting is probably going to be roughly 20 minutes, give or take. I tell people, plan about 10 minutes or so to talk about your own alopecia areata experience. You know, talk about what's been like for you before your loved one to have this disease. Then you can devote the second half of your meeting, roughly another 10 minutes, talking about the issues that you believe are most important for you and the community. And again, if you're not able to get to everything that we're asking for, that's okay, because they're going to have all that in the leave behind packet. But talk about the issues that are most important to you. Phil, is there anything you would like to add to that?
Nope. I think you hit the nail on the head on that. We don't want folks, and my job here in Washington is to focus on the policy and, you know, cut through all of the things you may read in your local newspaper in the national section, or you see on the news about, you know, what Congressman or Congresswoman X said and what Senator this one said and this and that, and cut through all the noise that really has taken over a lot of what's actually going on. No matter who the president is or who is in charge of the Senate or the House, they have to pass appropriation bills. They have to work together to figure things out. The Republicans and Democrats on the Appropriations Committee, despite what you might see about general Democrats and Republicans, work very well together on advancing these priorities. Everybody cares very much and deeply is concerned about what their constituents' priorities are and when they hear from them. And the relationships are what's key because, again, I can go into a lot of these offices, and I know that many folks here are I've been in meetings with, and you know, I saw Ebony, and it's nice to see Ebony. I haven't seen Ebony in a few years, but she would come to DC, and I had a very good relationship with one of her senators, Senator Stabenow, and her staff, just from my work. But what really put our request over the finish line with them was having Ebony there making that request as a constituent and saying, you know, I met locally with this staffer, and you know, I'm closing the loop here, and you know, her following up with the DC person and the local person. So, you know, my ego is never damaged that it doesn't take just me. It takes me plus a lot of advocates to move things over the finish line. So I can't underscore that enough, how critical it is for folks to get involved and to develop those relationships, because it really has proved beneficial over the past, you know, 7 years that I've been working with the foundation.
Phil, I'm really glad too that you touched upon the tumult in DC, because I think for people who, you know, just watch the news all the time, you get the impression that nothing ever gets done in DC, that there's no forward movement. And I can tell you, just in our experience, we've seen plenty of forward movement when Obama was president. We had movement going forward when Trump was president. We intend there to be movement going forward with the Biden presidency, because we're still able to work with both sides of the aisle. We've had Democrats, you know, sponsor our legislation. We've had Republicans co-sponsor our legislation. We're strictly nonpartisan. And, you know, we never tell you who to vote for or anything like that. You know, we strictly just stick to the issues of what's important for the alopecia areata community. Alopecia areata doesn't care what political party you belong to. Neither do we. Just as long as you're helping this community of 6.9 million Americans. That's what's important. Phil, you mentioned that we have Ebony Jean with us. I think I'll use that as a way to introduce the rest of our panelists now. We've got some really incredible patient advocates with us this evening. I'm so glad that they've been able to take the time to join us. I think what we'll do is I'm going to start with one, and I'll say your name. If you can then introduce yourself, and then if you want to then maybe pass the baton, as it were, to like another legislative liaison or legislative mentor, and that way we'll all kind of figuratively go around the room, as it were. So why don't we start then with Ebony Jean, joining us from Michigan. Hi, Ebony. You're muted. Ebony, can you take your mute off?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, my apologies. I'm sorry.
Problem.
Okay, hi everyone. I hope y'all are doing well. My name is Ebony Jean. I am from Michigan, and I have been a part of the Legislative Liaison Program since 2015. It is such an amazing opportunity to advocate for alopecia and to meet with Congress, going to Washington, D.C., and making that important connection, as Phil mentioned earlier. So I would like to pass it on to Christine.
Good evening, everyone. It's such an honor to be here. Thank you, Gary, for inviting me, and Phil for your wonderful presentation. My name is Christine Gauthier, and I have a job in Northern Virginia. I am a legislative liaison in Northern Virginia, and I also am lucky enough to be from the wonderful state of New Hampshire, where I own a condo in the mountains. And so I kind of step my foot into both offices, both in New Hampshire and in Virginia when I can. And one of the things that I have been so grateful for about this program, I started the legislative liaison program in 2017, I believe. And it was the first time in my life. I've had alopecia chronically for the last 16 years. And it was the first time in my life that I met someone else with alopecia and had an opportunity to share experiences that I've gone through really in isolation for over a decade and up until that point. And so not only was it, you know, fulfilling in that respect, but also very validating to be given a platform on Capitol Hill, to be given a purpose to channel the emotions and the thoughts that I've had about having alopecia in a constructive way. And I'm really grateful for Gary and Phil for their work on our behalf. And I will pass it on to George.
Let's see. Can you guys hear me? You can hear me? Okay. Hey, my name's George Bango. I've been doing it for not too long, about 3 years before COVID was the first year when we went to the Capitol Hill. So how I got involved with this, I'm from Syracuse, New York, but how I got involved, I have now a 16-year-old daughter who has alopecia. She was 13 at the time, and we knew nothing about it and had nowhere to go. And then just Google searching, I came across Gary Sherwood. And that's been, you know, it's been a blessing. We found kind of a home. We kind of found a lot about the program. I instantly, you know, jumped on this legislative liaison because I needed to find something, some way, some purpose, like Christine said, to help my daughter. And it's been, she's right now out for dinner with her friends and she'll be back. So I'm sure you'll get to meet her, but it's helped us. And my daughter is still very quiet about alopecia. She wears a prosthetic. Her hair grew back and then it comes out again. She goes to treatments once a week, but she's finally starting to take ownership. And I think it was the way that Gary kind of nurtured her into this program. She's a legislative mentor and she's been slowly becoming more vocal about it. And she's making her confirmation next week. And she made a speech about alopecia that she has to present in front of our bishop, which is really, really shocking. I'm going to be crying all over. But so she won. She made a speech. There were a bunch of kids that did it. And then I had text messages. I was coaching soccer at the time. And moms were like, oh, my God, your daughter's amazing. I can't believe she just talked about that. And she was so brave. So I owe it all to NAAF for that. That piece of it. So I'm in. I will do everything that Gary asks. I'll hound every senator and, you know, congressman. And I'm getting pretty good at it, actually. So I have a great track record. So that's where I'm at right now. And I'll pass it over to Tadush because he's a great kid. Go ahead, buddy.
Hi, everyone. We can you guys hear me? All right.
Yes.
We can hear you. So my name is Tanuj and I'm a junior in high school right now. I've had alopecia, you know, on and off throughout like my life. And at like one point I've lost like everything, even like my eyebrows. And like how I found NAAF and just this legislative liaison program, it's kind of a funny story. So my freshman year, I had a hernia and I got that surgery done. And I was just laying on my bed and we had a newsletter and we just saw the legislative liaison program. So then I immediately contacted Gary and he told me that you have to be 18. So then, you know, I just work with my mom, you know, cause I'm technically not a legislative liaison and, you know, this community, it's just great. You know, it's a good representation of alopecia, who we are. And, as I don't know if you guys know, I'm also a legislative mentor. So legislative mentors are people with people who aren't the voting age yet who want to be a part of this advocacy. And we personally, I feel like when a child talks to like, you know, the office, it really makes a great impact. And it's just a great community to be a part of, and I'm thankful for Gary and NAAF. And I'll pass it off to Judith.
Oh, Judith, I believe you're muted.
I just had a feeling he was gonna pass it on to me. He inspires me, honestly, to be a male and, you know, to talk about alopecia openly. I was diagnosed, well, to everybody, I'm kind of new to NAAF. I joined 2019 through a young lady called Quilla. She was doing some hair prostheses for kids who had cancer. And she told me about NAAF and I was like, what? I didn't know that, you know,
your you know, NAAF existed. So I right away contacted Gary to be on board. My story with alopecia started when I was 16. You know, I was just a normal teenager, you know, just very active, and, you know, my hair started falling out. And, you know, I was later diagnosed with lupus, but the symptoms was, you know, that first was noticeable was the alopecia. And I've been, you know, living with alopecia ever since. Sometimes I have times where my hair will, you know, be full. Sometimes it'll be patchy. And it's not easy living with this illness. And I'm still learning how to accept myself, you know, with this illness. So, you know, I'm very grateful to be a part of this panel. And I don't want to say too much. I hate talking about myself, but, you know, I'm just here to, you know, and I just feel like, you know, organizations like this is so important, because I know for a fact when I was 16, when I started losing my hair, if I knew others, because it was like a shame that I wore for a very long time. And I believe, you know, having this support system is great, especially for the young kids that are going through this. So I'm happy to be here. Who do I pass it on to?
I believe Abby.
Yes, I was just getting ready to say that.
Hi, can you hear me? Hi, I'm Abby. I live in New Orleans, Louisiana. Well, for now, I'm from Louisiana, kind of have lived all over in India, in DC, in Texas, and I'm moving to Michigan in 2 months for grad school. Yeah, so Ebony and I can tag team, moving to Ann Arbor. And I got involved with NAAF in probably 1999, a very long time ago, when I was six. I lost all of my hair, 90% of my hair, over the span of about a month, and it hasn't grown back. And my parents got super involved and were trying to do everything to fundraise, and started the tortoise and hare race. And I really enjoyed getting to go to DC, you know, pre-Gary, pre-legislative liaisons. That was like my favorite conference every 4 years when we went to DC. And it opened a lot of doors for me. I actually ended up meeting my senator in person, got to go to an event with her, stayed in touch with her, worked with her in college, studied political science, and ended up getting to meet even the Supreme Court justices through her. And yeah, it was really cool. So way back when, I've been involved with NAAF since, for the Legislative Liaison Program, since it started. And yeah, it's been a really great program for my career, as well as getting to, you know, see how much it's grown and the progress that we've made.
And, you know, it's interesting. Abby may have been the last panelist to be introduced, but as she mentioned, she was one of the very first legislative liaisons. When I came up with the idea for the program, I was flying home from that 2012 conference in DC, and I was writing down on a notepad, just like this one, the names of people who I had met at the conference who impressed me. And I had met Abby and her father at the time was NAAF's board chair. And Abby herself was working as a congressional staffer. And so she was one of like 12 people I put on that list. And so I remember sending her an invite, like, would you like to be part of this new program I'm beginning with NAAF? And luckily she said yes. And Abby, can I ask you, since you were a congressional staffer, you have like a rare insight as to, like, you know, what it's like to be on the other side of these meetings. What are like maybe some tips you could advise, like some do's and don'ts of being an effective advocate when you meet with your legislators or their staff?
Yeah, I feel like, so that was 8 years ago that I worked on the Hill. It's crazy. It's been that long. I'm feeling old. But yeah, let's see. I think, Oh man, putting me on the spot. I think, you know, just having those, like what Phil was talking about earlier, having those personal stories, like the more people that you can really like rope into your cause, and, you know, encouraging people to really like tell their authentic story, it does make a difference. you know, I see one of my senators quite frequently when he's in town, just like around, you know, Louisiana is a very small place. And he always like remembers alopecia and is like asking me about it or like what new legislation we have. Unfortunately, he hasn't signed on yet, but you know, we're still working on it. And it's at least very much on his radar. And I think just creating that awareness, I remember, and one story I remember, I don't know if this is from even before starting legislative liaisons, but a long, long time ago, I remember one really impactful moment from a Hill day. Someone went into like formerly Senator Obama's office, and there was someone who worked in the office who had alopecia, and she just started crying and was like, I've never met anyone who had alopecia. And so you kind of never know like what will come out of the day. Like you never know like who could be your next champion. You know, obviously Representative Presley has alopecia, but you don't know like who in that office, maybe a staffer has alopecia or one of the congressman's family members or something. So yeah, I think just like sharing your authentic story and talking about the challenges you face and what you would like to see done is probably the most effective thing.
And just to let everyone know, here's what a rock star Abby is. Even when she was living in India, she would still be advocating with her senators and congresspeople back in the States on behalf of the alopecia areata community. So Abby, you've just been tremendous. And again, I don't think the program would have been nearly as successful had you not been one of those original 12. So really appreciate all you've done. And I just wanted to ask, if I could, a couple other panelists some questions while I've got you on here, and then I think we're going to open it to the floor. George, it's interesting, kind of like how you've been advocating. What you did was you leveraged a special relationship, and I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about that.
So one more, I'm a school teacher. I teach middle school math, and I was driving late to work and I saw a car. It was like a pink car that was for breast cancer. And I was like, you know what? Maybe this person would probably be interested in winning a bill for wigs. So she was getting asked at 7 during the morning, and I came over to her, and it's Alec Baldwin's sister, Carol Baldwin, you know, the Baldwin brothers, that you know, the famous Baldwin brothers that plays Donald Trump for Saturday Night Live. So it's his sister, and it was called the Carol Baldwin Foundation for Breast Cancer. So at 7:30 in the morning, she's pumping gas, and I came up to her and I started telling her my whole story of my daughter, and she didn't even have a cup of coffee yet. And she's looking at me, she's like, you know what? I'm gonna give you my phone number and we're gonna talk. And I said, okay, perfect. So I called her again that afternoon, and then she came over to my house and we sat down and talked, and I told her, she met my daughter, and she goes, I'm on board. This is going to help me as well, because she does a lot of fundraising for breast cancer, and some of the money goes to people with wigs that she has that are going to chemo. So we made a partnership, and she comes over quite, you know, a couple times a month, and we will, she has no problem doing the Skypes or the meetings with the different senators or the Congress people that we get to meet with. And she's got a lot of clout. She throws her brother's names around a lot. She does raise like $10 million a year for breast cancer in New York State. So they listen to her, and it seems like the staffers are interested in hearing her story. So it seems like every time we make a meeting, it goes through, it doesn't get canceled. And so that's been helpful. And then our congressmen also here in Syracuse, our upstate congressman, we made a relationship with him. His name's Senator Katko, and he's a Republican. And he actually coached hockey with my brother-in-law. And his wife does like fit body boot camp, and I have friends that go there. So all the little connections that we make, you know, I'm always talking about it, and through friends and different networkings, it seems like it's been helpful for us, especially in New York State. And then we got to even help Janusz out with Cory Booker in New Jersey. We joined some of his meetings. So I think we're on a roll, and she's on board to help out. So that's kind of where I'm at.
That's great, George. Again, I think Beth Baldwin's been a real time. Sounds and good, I give you all the credit in the world for leveraging that relationship. That's been great. And, you know, you just mentioned Tanuj. Tanuj, can I ask?
Does anyone else want to talk?
I'm sorry. I was just going to ask Tanuj, can I ask you, since you are a legislative mentor, as you said, a legislative mentor is someone who's interested in the legislative process but is not yet of voting age. What would you advise to other young people who are interested in the legislative process?
Well, so like, you mean like kids who want to be a part of our program?
Sure. Yeah.
Well, to start off, I mean, just like in terms of advice, so as a background for what our program does, I'll start with that first. So what we do, we try to get in contact with our local staffers as well. You know, we let them know. Can you please provide more clarification, like your question?
Sorry. Oh, yeah, of course. I would say, like, if we have people who are watching this and they're not yet 18, they're not yet of voting age, but they would like to get involved somehow legislatively, you know, what can they do?
Well, like to be a part of our program, mm-hmm, like, sure. So I'm not sure if you can always reach out to Gary or one of us if you want to be a part of this program. And we're always like looking to recruit more legislative mentors because, you know, it's the more the merrier. And I'm a little confused with the question.
No, that was fine. As Tanuj said, we do have a Ledge Mentor Program. It's something that was started relatively recently, I believe about a year and a half ago when we were in DC for our last in-person Hill Day in September of 2019. And so if you or someone in your family below the age of 18 is interested in the program, feel free to write me at gary@naaf.org. I'll be happy to tell you more about it. And we do meet once a month, both the parents and the mentors themselves. And it's sort of like a secondary component to our advocacy committee, which is made up of our more veteran legislative liaisons. So if that's something you'd like to do, please get in touch with me. I want to ask our host, Angela and Renee, I know that I've been monopolizing a lot of the time here. Should I now open the floor up to questions from the audience? Do we have some coming in?
Yes, that would be good.
Okay, very good. If someone would like to read them, or do we put them on mic? I'm not exactly sure what the protocol is here.
Me and Angela, we just kind of tag team and just read some of the questions out. And I believe the only one that I see so far was how to get involved. And I believe that you answered that. And I believe Heather asks, is there grassroots and communities in Northern California?
Well, as a matter of fact, you know, NAAF is headquartered in San Rafael. So yeah, this is sort of much, you know, the epicenter for everything that NAAF does. We're currently, unfortunately, not able to work in the office for the last 14 months, 15 months, whatever it's been now. We've been working from home. I'm in Santa Rosa, California. But we have legislative liaisons all over the country. Anywhere you live, you can become a legislative liaison and meet with your congressional representatives and your senators. All you gotta do is just contact me at gary@naaf.org. And what I usually do is I send you the prep packet, the leave behind packet for you to look over, so you get a better idea of what we talk about in our meetings, so you know what those issues are. And then we arrange a time to talk one-on-one. And I answer any questions that you have, and I help you get your meeting set up. So just reach out to me. I think someone from Southern California is asking the same question, and it's the same answer. Just reach out to me. We have lots of legislative liaisons in Northern California and Southern California. In fact, a group of us recently just all had like a big virtual call with the office of our new senator in California. And so we also want to do another call very soon, we hope, with the office of Dianne Feinstein, who's our more senior senator. So yeah, just reach out to me, Gary@NAAF.org. Be happy to tell you more.
Great, thank you, Gary. I have a few questions that I'll be asking kind of within the, or between the different questions that those in the audience ask. I do see a question in the Q&A section, and it's from Valerie, and her question is specifically to Gary and Phil. And she asks, what motivated you to get involved with NAAF and get involved with our community to support our community?
Well, for myself, I had been doing public policy work for State Farm Insurance for 13 years. I loved legislative advocacy. I did not so much love doing it for a major insurance company. And so I was looking for nonprofits who might need someone to do their advocacy. And I stumbled across NAAF. NAAF needed the communications director. I went in and interviewed with NAAF. And I told them in my very first interview, I said that, look, I'll be more than happy to do your communications, but what I really want to do is work on patient advocacy. And luckily our CEO at the time, Vicki Kalibokas, agreed. She grew up in Washington, DC. She was very well acquainted with how important patient advocacy was. And so, as I mentioned earlier, I then went to that conference in DC that summer, and that's where I came up with the idea for the legislative liaison. But it's just a process which I learned working at State Farm, and I really love the intricacies of it. I really love the relationship building. It's very social, which I am. And so that's something I wanted to do, but I wanted to do it for people who need it. I specifically remember my last day at State Farm, my best friend there, first I'm still friends with, her name is Liz. She and I were sitting on the hood of my car, and she was asking, so what are you going to do now? And I said, I'm just going to go on Craigslist and start looking for nonprofits. And so luckily, several months later is when I found NAAF. And the rest, as they say, is history. Phil, how about you?
So I'll say that fortunately for me, NAAF and Gary were already working with my firm when I joined. Prior to joining my firm, I worked on Capitol Hill and the House of Representatives for two New York members. But very fortunate to have been introduced to Gary and the folks at NAAF, and have developed a great relationship over the past 7 years, where we've been working on advancing our key priorities. And you know, I work with any number of organizations who support robust research funding, who are looking for more education and awareness. But what really drives me is the community, to be quite honest, and to see so many people being involved, and to see just the advocacy that's done from the grassroots level. Again, I can go in and speak with people, but when you guys are here in DC, or you guys are part of the meeting and share your story, that's what's most powerful to me, and I know to offices. And because people will often hear, DC government relations person, and they think ill, swamp, like bad person. What fuels me is the fact that, we are making a difference in the work that we do, and the work that we do is meaningful, and it's not for some, corporation that's just thinking about profits, but, we are really making a difference. And to be able to see where the research portfolio and where everything is now versus where it was, 7 years ago, and what's on the horizon is really a great motivating factor for me. And just the personal relationships that I've developed over the years with many folks who are panelists here are always helpful to keep me going in the midst of everything else that's happening.
And I'll just mention too, NAAF is a business. And every year, all of us have to justify our expenses. And I always tell them, look, there's no way we're not working with Phil and Health and Medicine Council. They have proven their worth time and time again. They have been great friends of this community. And so luckily I never get any pushback on that. I mean, you know, it's never been an argument as to whether or not we're going to keep the Health and Medicine Council and Phil and everyone else that he works with, because they have been absolutely instrumental in our successes. So really appreciate them. And I see we're getting a lot more questions coming in now.
I did see a couple of questions, but it looked like Judith had a question for Abby, and then it looked like Heather had a question and Abby was responding a bit. But we'll go to Judith first, and then we'll go to Heather's question.
I wanted Abby to mention the year again that she got diagnosed with alopecia.
Yeah, 1999.
Oh my God, that's the same year I got diagnosed. So it's like, it's all coming, yeah, this is all coming back to me, because that was the same year I also got diagnosed with lupus. And, you know, your story just inspired me. And I just wanted to tell you, I'm so proud. You know, I don't know, what age were you?
I was six.
Wow. I was 16. And, we got the 16 in common as well. Six and, you know, 16, the number six in 1999. Yeah. You know, I didn't want, like, it's so hard for me to talk about, you know, my experience with alopecia, because it was devastating a bit, to say the least. And because I was running for Miss Teen New Jersey at the time. It was one of these American collegiate pageants. And I remember prior to the pageant, my hair was falling out. So I was like, oh, well, you know, maybe I'm perming it too much. So let me just braid it and give it a break. And that was the most, the day that I took the braids out, like all my hair just was in my hand, and it was just devastating. And, you know, I felt like my glory was taken away, and it just kind of made me live in a shell. But, you know, I was always very vocal about, you know, talking about lupus for some reason. And just seeing you, you know, for it to happen to you at such a young age, and being able to talk about it and being an advocate for it, you know, that just, you know, raises my spirit up, and it kind of inspires me. So I just wanted to say that to you.
Oh, thank you. Well, I think, you know, sorry, they're roofing my house right now. I didn't know that was happening today.
Yeah.
But no, I think, you know, in some ways, like being a lot younger, it was a little bit easier, just because I can't really remember my life with hair, you know?
Right.
So, I mean, I have more respect for people who lost their hair in their teens or 20s or later, just because they know what their life was like when they had hair.
Right. Right. Yeah. It's not an easy experience. Not at all. Especially amongst your peers, because that was like the first time I ever had to wear a wig. And because a lot of people at that time was like, oh, well, Judith just cut her hair, because I had hair down to my back and very thick hair. But there were those that were kind of nosy and wanted to find out that, nah, I don't think that's her hair. I think she got a wig on. And I remember I was in a classroom, and one of the, you know, my peers, like, you know, I felt their hand in the back of my head, and I turned around and I looked, and another girl was like, she knew, like, it was just devastating. So I've always had this, this shell about talking about alopecia. But when, you know, Quilla told me about what the Alopecia Foundation does, and, you know, donating wigs, I right away jumped on board. And I'm just realizing this is the same shirt that I wore when I went to Congressman Payne's office, because I go there all the time to see him and Cory Booker, you know, to get funds for lupus. So, yeah, you just inspire me.
St. Judith, do you tell that story when you meet with your legislators' offices? Do you tell them your own personal experience with alopecia?
Yes, I definitely did. Because I've kind of developed a relationship with Congressman Payne, because I am an adjunct professor. So I teach at Essex County College, and like, I'm right across the street from him. But, you know, when I've gone to DC, obviously, and done Hill Day, but not for alopecia, and I can't wait to have that experience. I usually talk about my personal experience, and he even shared his with me, where, you know, he went through a patchy moment in his life And, you know, he was quite welcoming when I went there to talk to him about alopecia.
I see that Ebony is raising her hand.
Hey, Gary, I saw Heather in the chat had a question before Ebony raised her hand. But I love you.
Heather and then Ebony.
So I want to make sure I kind of ask this correctly. And Abby, you jump in if it doesn't sound like I'm asking Heather's question correctly, because it sounds like maybe you might have a better grasp of what she was asking. But Heather was interested in the chat to know the connection between alopecia and other autoimmune conditions in terms And Abby was interested in maybe having you, Gary, talk about the connection between NAAF and NIMES. Hopefully I'm pronouncing that correctly.
Yeah, and NIMES. I know that Gary does do a lot of work with other like similar conditions. So I thought I would give that question, that he would be the best person to answer that question.
Perfect. And then the last thing, Gary, before you answer that, it also sounds like Heather was saying that like it seems like most funding goes to other autoimmune conditions like lupus or other prominent conditions. And so is the kind of promotion of increasing funding for autoimmune conditions in general so that you get like a small portion of those funds? So just if you can talk a little bit about that.
Okay, well, I'll talk about what I know. And I honestly don't know how much goes to like other, conditions, but I can tell you that what they're finding often, what's effective treatment towards one autoimmune condition often crosses over to other autoimmune conditions. So what's good for lupus conceivably could be good for someone with alopecia areata. That's something that they're discovering more and more. I can tell you though that funding for alopecia areata research has gone up. I forget what it is. Phil, you can answer this better than I could. I think it's gone up at least 12-fold since 2012, since we started the program. I know it's gone up quite a bit. Am I correct?
Yes, yeah, so it has increased. And I will say that what helps get more money is educating members of Congress about the importance of alopecia areata. There are, you know, NIH has research portfolios on a lot of conditions, and, you know, we always support, you know, the biggest amount that NIH overall can receive. And then from there, they break that down to these different institutes and, you know, the professionals at NIAM, such as the director and some of their key folks are the ones who then decide, you know, what funding goes into those types of portfolios. So, you know, we always, the higher the tide, you know, the higher the boat goes. So we support the most robust NIH funding possible. And then we work with the leadership of NIAMS to highlight the importance of alopecia research and make sure that there are these specific recommendations from Congress that, encourage more research to be done on an annual basis, which then requires these institutes and NIH, when they report back to Congress, to let them know what they're doing in the research space and how they plan to respond to Congress's request. But those requests only occur because members are more familiar with alopecia areata and are champions of the community.
And we do work with other skin disease organizations through the Coalition of Skin Diseases and with the American Academy of Dermatology. I know Ebony has her hand up, so we're going to answer Ebony's question next. But then I want to ask, and Christine, I'm giving you some advance warning here. I'm going to ask Christine to talk more about when we've gone and we've advocated with these other organizations and the CSD and with the AADA.
Maybe we should just define NIAMS real quick for people who might not know. I think it's the National Institute for Arthritis and Multiskeletal Disorders, right?
Sorry, go ahead, Gary.
Because you were throwing that around.
I was going to say for you, Phil, because I can never do it off the top of my head because it's such a mouthful. I literally have to Google it. It is the National Institute of Arthritis, Musculoskeletal, and Skin Diseases. So I think then let's move on and finally answer Ebony's questions. Her hand has been up for like the last 3 hours now. So Ebony, Wait, what would you like to ask us, my dear?
Actually, I wanted to resonate with Judith's story. I remember just a few minutes ago, she was talking about wearing wigs and the hair pulling. I can definitely relate to that. I was diagnosed with alopecia at the age of 4. So my mom discovered the hair patches while she was combing my hair one day. And so after getting the test run and the diagnosis was positive, it was a really difficult journey. So I've actually been wearing wigs since the age of 9, and my mom made my very first headband wig. Back in the early 2000s, it wasn't sold in stores, and I had such a difficult time just accepting what was going on or understanding what was going on with me. I remember going to school every single day, kids pulling behind my wig, like they're pulling my ponytail, trying to see if it's real, you know, if it's fake, if it'll come off and things like that. And that really did something to my confidence. I didn't go public with my story until 2016. And I've been speaking with Gary ever since then, you know, just working with this organization and being able to share it with other people. So I just wanted to let you know that I have a lot of respect for you. And if you have any questions, definitely feel free to reach out.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
You're welcome.
And Ebony, I believe you and Judith were both pageant competitors as well. They have that in common too.
Really?
Yeah.
You know, that was just my first stint at it, because everybody just seems like you just have a gorgeous face and all that. I wasn't really into myself at that time. So I was trying it for confidence, and you know, I made state finalists, but then I couldn't, you know, continue on because my hair fell out. And it was just devastating at the time. And I just didn't know how to handle it. It was just my mom that calmed me down. And, you know, I wouldn't wish that experience on anybody, where you're taking out your braids and all this hair is in your hand. And I remember screaming in the bathroom. It was just horrific. It was like a horror movie. And then having to go to school the next day and being self-conscious, like, you know, that, you know, someone is, or is it going to fall off? And, you know, but I mean, it later became a trend because I started seeing people wearing wigs in the school, but it still didn't help with my self-confidence, because a woman's hair is her glory. And, you know, to lose hair at that age where, you know, it's mostly about vanity. You know, I always say this, I was like, you know, especially when I'm talking about, you know, lupus, I'm like, you know, lupus have done so much to me, but, you know, like, don't touch my hair, you know, like, you know, like, you can do whatever to me, but do not touch my hair. And, you know, you would understand, and others will understand what it's like for a woman of color to have full length hair and strong hair. And, you know, I just never thought that this would be my story, you know, to deal with that. Yeah. So, you know, meeting people like you and Abby, and, you know, that are living it and thriving with it, you know, it just really, you know, it's full circle. It comes home. And, you know, I just feel like I have a community that I can talk to people about. You know, the whole hair issues, because even in the lupus community, not everybody loses their hair. So yeah, it varies.
Absolutely. It definitely varies. In fact, lupus runs on my dad's side of the family. So all of my aunts have it. And I've been wondering, you know, if I have any correlation with that in right. terms of alopecia as well. Yeah. But I definitely know what it's like to feel like the oddball, and, you know, people asking, is that your real hair? Do you feel right. like, you know, that matters? And growing up, that is definitely vanity. You know, we're all concerned about how we look and wondering if our peers will accept us. And I had my mom to encourage me to yeah. keep going, because there were many days where I skipped school. I did not mm-hmm. appreciate, you know, people just mistreating me. And I've even dealt with educators wanting to send me home because of everything that happened. Uh-huh. Concerning my alopecia. So in terms of the pageantry, I remember competing in a local pageant before going to Miss Michigan USA. So I competed and I became the first African-American alopecian to compete in our state competition. But even then, I didn't feel like I qualified because I had to wear a wig. I had to go through that entire process of getting ready. And, you know, it was just, it did something to my confidence. So yeah,
it definitely does. Because even when it grows back, it's not the same type of hair.
Right.
And you know, Gary mentioned something earlier on that some of the medications that is used is also used for alopecia. Of course, I had the many steroid injections, just like I was getting steroid injections for other things concerning lupus. So yeah, there's a correlation there. There's definitely a correlation there.
Absolutely.
So I'd like to ask, and thank you both. That was a great discussion. I'd like to ask Christine, you've accompanied me to the Coalition of Skin Diseases when they have their Hill Day in Washington, D.C., along with the American Academy of Dermatology. And that's an opportunity for NAAF to join forces with other skin disease organizations as well. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about that, about what it's like to go to the Hill with other disease groups and what we ask for.
My first impression, my first experience in a meeting with other dermatologists was I was late because my cab was stuck in traffic and DC morning commute traffic. I rushed into this meeting with another woman, two other doctors, actually dermatologists who were also in the same boat. So I felt a little bit better, but then the doors opened and there were, I think, 20 dermatologists sitting along this very long, very important looking table. And I'm the only person wearing a wig in the room. And part of my process when I go into these meetings is I'm always wearing my cranial prosthetic. That costs almost $3,000. It's a custom-made prosthetic that my insurance thankfully covers after many months of arguing with them every single year. We go through this every year, but they ultimately cover it. But, you know, I take it off. And that was the first time, Gary, when I sat in with the dermatologist, where I took it off in front of so many people. And that was really... still send shivers down my spine thinking about, you know, doing that in front of so many people who didn't
know
me.
That's so great.
And like, oh my God, you know, I was just thinking, I'm doing this for millions of people who need the help and they need for their elected officials to understand what this is all about. Personally, for me, it was very informative. I had no idea about some of the other skin diseases that exist and that need support and funding for research. I was also really touched and humbled and impressed by some of the asks that the dermatologists were, you know, they had as their platform, wanting to just be able to do their jobs as dermatologists and be able to prescribe their patients the medications that they knew as educated professionals were going to be appropriate for their clients, for their patients. Hearing their stories about what they deal with the insurance companies, with the insurance industry, how big of a machine it is and how many roadblocks it imposes, it puts up in our lives. I also got the opportunity to meet some other people who had skin diseases, and we were able to go into different legislators' offices and talk about our various disease experiences. And so that was also, it just made the world... Having a rare disease makes you feel like we're all saying, like, you know, no one else really knows and we're so isolated. And so it was really wonderful to speak with other people who have similar emotional traumas, you know, whatever their disease process is, it's affected them emotionally somehow, and to be able to connect and validate each other's experiences and recognize each other. And our voices as being important for, you know, the causes that we're after. So I also have to say, Gary, I've never been to such a nice dinner that the American Academy of Dermatology treated us to. I have never been in such a fancy room in my life. I thought, wow, you know,
Yeah,
the dermatology is where it's at.
They lay out a good spread.
Oh my gosh. Yeah,
I'm sure of it because they charge so much just to see you. They charge a lot.
Champagne and steaks and mahogany walls and chandeliers. It was quite something.
Yeah, it ain't bad. It ain't bad. And again, I would just underscore the reason that we belong to the Coalition of Skin Diseases is so we can pool our resources with these other skin disease organizations, which are frequently making similar asks. In fact, full disclosure here, for 3 years, I was overseeing the CSD's advocacy efforts as well as NAAF's advocacy efforts. And I would always, I guess, how would you say, keep like a thumb on the scale to make sure that everything the CSD was asking for was also things that NAAF was asking for. So it wasn't just the legislative liaisons and the alopecia areata community, but it was the whole skin disease community that belonged to the CSD were asking for the same things. And so I was really grateful that it wasn't just Christine, we had Ebony, we had a few other alleged liaisons join me as well with this CSD. And that's something which again, post-pandemic, we intend to be doing again. In fact, something the CSD has been discussing is that they might have their own Hill Day as something separate from the American Academy of Dermatology. We would still go with the AAD when they have their Hill Day as well, because it's good for us to go in with the dermatologists, but we would really like to have our own Hill Day as well. And so that conceivably we would have the NAAF Hill Day, the CSD Hill Day, and the AADA Hill Day that we would be taking part in all at the same time. So we'd really be getting the message out there about alopecia areata. So that's something we're looking forward to again. Hopefully by 2022 or 23, we'll see that again.
I can't wait.
Are there any other questions coming into us?
There definitely was a question, and I also had the same question. Christine, it's for you. And the question was, what insurance do you have that's covering your prosthetic?
Right.
Okay, so I have a YouTube channel called Alopecian Life, and I have a YouTube video devoted to this topic because, and it's gotten the most hits out of all the videos I've ever done because it's such a big issue. I have Aetna through my employer. I have to say that, so being from New Hampshire, New Hampshire requires, when I was living in New Hampshire and had to get my first cranial prosthetic, I was told initially by my insurance carrier at the time that that alopecia is a cosmetic problem. And so therefore I don't need a wig because I'm just superficial. I need to get over my superficiality because the insurance company can't be bothered with my own personal values and emotions and feelings. I had a wonderful woman at the time who owned this wig store that where I've gone for several years to get my cranial prosthetics. And she knew New Hampshire law, which she educated me on, and which says that if you live in New Hampshire, any insurance company in New Hampshire that does business for people in New Hampshire is legally mandated to treat alopecia as they would cancer, which means for cancer patients, they get a wig on an annual basis. Right. And so I then appealed my insurance company and they backed off and they provided the funding for my wig. The other things that I've learned as a feature of having alopecia is when my annual enrollment comes around for health insurance, if there are new policies or if there are changes to policies, I'm always looking at the durable medical equipment fine print in that aspect of my policy to see if there have been any changes to Aetna's plan or if there's something better. So that's something that I always advise people to look for as well. I've been a faithfully paying participant in their plan for the last 6 years. And even though this wig store that I've worked with for the last 10 years, I think, is considered an in-network provider, I'm now in my fourth month of arguments with Aetna about paying for my wig. And it's exhausting. And so it'll be so wonderful when this legislation is finally passed And I say that in future tense because I believe it will be. But it's, you know, and it's very demoralizing. So I can empathize with everyone who's going through that. And this is something that I think all of us can attest to. And in my work as a legislative liaison, these are stories that are common for everyone, unfortunately. But I think that the more that I learn as a legislative liaison about alopecia, the more I hear stories from doctors about, you know, saying hair has a function. This is a medical disease. It needs to be given the same credence as breast cancer or as any other disease does through their insurance carriers, and the same kind of empathetic treatment and informed treatment. The more I think we'll have an impact as it relates to having cranial prosthetics covered. So looking into if your insurance company isn't covering your wig or if they're giving you the runaround, you can always, what I've learned is you can go to the labor department in my case, which is what I intend to do if Aetna doesn't figure itself out really quickly, or you can petition your, the insurance commissioner at your state level, if you feel as though your insurance company isn't, following through on their end of the obligation of their obligations to you as a patient, if they're not honoring your policy.
Wow, thank you for that information. I'm definitely gonna email you for some steps, because I know, in the Medicaid community, they stopped giving wigs to alopecia patients, claim it is cosmetic, which does not make sense to me, because with cancer patients, there's like a 50% chance that their hair will grow back after chemotherapy, but it's not the same for, people with alopecia. So it's quite difficult that they see it as cosmetic. And I know many patients that are now, living in that fear because the cranial prostheses are more fitted for your head than, the $10 wigs and things like that you would get at the wig store. So it's definitely been a fight, and I hope that Medicare also, gets the approval that it needs to give it to the patients that need it, because they don't realize how it can literally cause depression, anxiety, shatter someone's life, but they see it as cosmetic, and it's not at all.
Yeah, and I think Christine's experience really underscores why we need that legislation to pass. I mean, no one should have to haggle for 4 months with their insurance carrier to get something which, should really rightfully be yours. You're making the same premiums that the cancer patient is.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so I can tell you, at the outset, I mentioned that I worked for a Fortune 500 insurer for, 13 years. And just in my own experience, what I saw was they usually determine coverages by what does the competition cover? And if they don't see the competition covering something, they have no incentive to cover it either. But if one carrier should start to offer it, then you'll start to see a snowball effect. And then the rest of them start to offer it as well. The example I always use is motorcycle insurance, which hardly anyone used to have motorcycle insurance. Hardly any carriers would offer it because it would be so expensive if someone got in a motorcycle mishap. The bills would be tremendous. You could be in the hospital for months on end in rehabilitation. So hardly anyone would offer it, or if they did, it was prohibitively expensive. And then Geico started offering it low cost. And you would see all the TV ads for it. And then Geico suddenly got a huge share of the market, because if you're gonna insure your motorcycle, of course you're gonna insure your car with them. And auto insurance is called the gateway drug in the insurance business, because once you insure your car with them, well, now you'll insure your home and you'll get your fire and your life and everything else with that carrier. So that's why Geico is now like a huge major player, because they had the foresight to offer motorcycle insurance. And so we're really hoping with our bill, when cranial prosthetics are redesignated as durable medical equipment and you'll see Medicaid start to cover it, then you'll see the private insurers will cover it as well to stay competitive. So I agree with you, Christine. I think it's going to pass too. We get more and more co-sponsors for the bill. Every time a new iteration of the bill should drop in Congress. We actually had more co-sponsors on the last iteration of the bill in 2020 during the pandemic when we could only meet virtually like this. We couldn't do in-person meetings. We had more co-sponsors that year than any other year. So I'm pretty certain that, like, you know, once the new bill drops and once we're able to go back to like having like a real Ernest Hill day in person, like we planned to in June of 2022. I think there's a very good chance that the bill, you know, will see enough votes to gain passage. So, you know, fingers crossed, but we need all of you to get behind it. We need more ledge liaisons establishing these relationships and making the asks. So any other questions for us?
There is a question, again, directed at Christine. There is an individual who wanted your YouTube page. Do you mind chatting or typing it in the chat for us?
Of course. Yeah, I was kind of trying to find it, but I haven't found it yet. So I'm glad that question was asked.
No, thank you for asking. I'll be happy to provide that. 1 second.
And then I just had a question. I was jotting down a couple questions for myself. So I'm picturing... I mean, most of this group seems pretty extroverted. I might be taking a leap with assuming that, but I'm thinking of a lot of people who are not as comfortable kind of sharing their story, but still wanna be involved with advocacy, people who might feel a bit nervous or anxious talking to someone, you know, as prestigious as like a, you know, representative or senator. Or even someone, you know, working in that office. And so what advice do you have for someone who is a bit more introverted or shy and a bit kind of intimidated by talking to these individuals in leadership?
Oh, I love that question, Angela. And I would say, take a stiff drink. No, don't do that. I would say in all seriousness, please, by all means, bring someone with you. You know, it's good to like either bring in like a family member or a close friend or someone else, you know, who has alopecia areata. Go in there with someone you know. And, you know, if you don't really feel comfortable talking too much about yourself, that's okay. You know, just as long as you introduce yourself, you just let them know I have alopecia areata. You can give them then the leave behind materials, because all the meetings are currently still virtual. You know, get the name and the email address of the person you're going to meet with, and just send them a PDF of our leave behind packet, which, as I mentioned earlier, I provide to you. And that packet has all the information that they could possibly want about alopecia areata and NAAF. It has a patient story in there. It's a new patient. We update the patients every couple of years. So our new patient in there is McKenna Wright, who is a woman in her 30s who has alopecia areata. She lives in Ohio. And so they can like actually read that person's experience as well, if you'd rather not talk about your own experience. And then it lists all the asks. So you don't really need to talk a lot, but you know, it's whatever you're most comfortable with. And again, you don't need to go for having other people in the meeting.
Can I chime in real quick on that? Can you guys hear me? Sometimes my computer was a little glitchy. So I went one time to Senator Gillibrand's office with a few ladies that I kind of met that had alopecia in upstate New York that came with me. And I was the lead that I kind of organized it. And I talk a lot being a teacher. And when we were in the meeting, there were one of the ladies that had alopecia. She was very quiet. And when we were in the meeting, I figured, all right, I should probably stop talking. And she was quiet, but I think when she did speak, it was more powerful than what I was blabbing about, telling my story about my daughter, because you could see her emotion. And when she started talking, she did start crying right away, because her son now has alopecia and she feels like, you know, She passed it on to him. And she started crying. And then I looked over at the two staffers and they started crying. And then everyone, I'm the only guy in the place right now. And there's, I'm with about eight ladies and my daughter and everyone's crying. And then she signed the bill that day. So she co-sponsored the bill. I guess the two staffers called her and, you know, I found out that, you know, the next morning I got a message on my phone that Senator Gillibrand signed on. So, you know, I don't think you have to be the gift of gab speaker. I think it was more powerful watching her and the emotion. I thought that was a better sales pitch than my rehearsed speech, you know? So I don't know if that should help other people. Don't be scared. We were petrified when we first went. My daughter still doesn't like to talk about it, but when she does, you know, you can see the emotion. And I think that resonates, you know, with the staffers.
Christine has her hand up.
I'd love to have her.
Yeah, and I don't know how much time we have.
I think I'm done talking.
I don't know how much time we have, so I don't want to take up too much more time, but my first experience doing this was after speaking with Gary for maybe 15 minutes on the phone, and you gave the rundown that you've just given, Gary. Just, you know, speak to what's important to you and tell your story. And I met in Congressman Byer's office. He's our Alexandria representative. And the woman I met with, so that, you know, I had this impression that I was going to walk into someone's mahogany-walled, chandeliered office, you know, and I was in a corner in a hallway with boxes stacked around us in this old, creaky, old wooden table and, you know, chairs that were ratty. The stuffing was coming out of the upholstery. And I thought, wow, this is really disarming. I'm actually glad. It's kind of a it did not meet my expectations. I was really glad. So it gave me the impression that there are very fancy offices on Capitol Hill or in your state legislators' offices, but there are also the staffers' offices, and those are much different. And you're meeting with the staffers most of the time. And I know that they've had experience too, talking with people who've done this for the first time. I think they're pretty understanding. I've never had anyone make me feel like I'm not saying the right thing. And I think the most important thing for me to remember when I go into these meetings is that no one else knows my experience but me. Yeah. I know my experience better than anyone else in that room. And because of that, I am the best voice for what I need. And I can clarify any confusion for them. I can help them understand. If they're not sure what alopecia is, how it affects people personally, with the insurance business that we're talking about, health-related issues. And that has always given me a sense of confidence, knowing that nobody else can know what it's like to walk in my shoes. And that's the very reason I'm there, to help them understand.
Thank you, Chris. I know a few people want to say something and comment.
Yeah, I wanted to say something too, to what George said.
As comment, because I want us to wrap up as we're finishing.
Yeah, yeah.
As you comment on this answer, can you also add in, as we wrap up, one piece of advice you give to individuals who are listening, who want to get involved with advocacy in this way?
And before we close out after everybody speaks, Gary, I want for you to kind of reiterate how people can get involved and also to talk a little bit about the conference coming up.
Oh, be happy to. So if you want to get involved legislatively, please write to me, gary@naaf.org, and I will get back to you as soon as I can. And then if you know someone, like say, who is below the age of voting age, but wants to get involved in the legislative mentor program, same thing, just write to me, gary@naaf.org, and I'll tell you more about that. And then, okay, the conference. The conference is called Lunapecia. I don't know who came up with that name. Oh, wait, no, that was me. And it's because obviously we can't all be in the same place in person, got to do it virtually again. So I was thinking, where's some place we could never go normally? Well, we could never go to the moon. So I think let's do the conference from the moon, hence Lunapecia. And also too, because this virtual conference will be out of this world. And it's going to be for 3 days, June 25th, June 26th, and June 27th. That's a Friday through Sunday. Each day is going to have a different focus. So that Friday, June the 25th, the focus will be advocacy and awareness. June the 26th will be research. And then Sunday, June 27th will be support. And so we are still finalizing guest speakers and other cool things we're going to do, but it's going to be a lot of fun. And then looking ahead, we expect, fingers crossed, that our first post-COVID in-person conference will be in June of 2022 in DC. So we're all looking forward to that. The hotel has been really understanding, good to work for us when we had to, cancel it last year. We all got out our calendars and looked ahead. And so we're so psyched about coming back and all being together again. So that will be in another 13 months. But next month, if you haven't done so already, please register for Lunapecia. You can go on the NAAF website and find the registration information on there. And we really look forward to having you. And oh, and also too, the cool thing about the virtual conference is when you register, you not only can watch everything live over those 3 days, you have 30 days in which to watch or rewatch all the material because it's all going to be recorded. So it's like you can kind of have the conference in your own home for a whole month afterwards. Please register if you haven't already.
Thank you so much, Gary. And we're also in the process of trying to figure out if financial aid will be available for this year's conference. I was told that we're not quite sure yet. So
I'll tell you, I can't answer definitively, but I can tell you this. It costs a lot less to register for the virtual conference. The in-person conference is usually about costs anywhere from 3 to 4 times what the virtual conference costs. Mm-hmm. So it's all right. I think the virtual conference is like $99 this year. And throwing into that no one has to get a hotel or, fly anywhere or incur buying gas or anything. It's already a pretty sweet deal. But I would say, if you still need financial help, feel free to write us. We'll see what we can do, but I can't promise. Normally when it's an in-person conference, we do offer scholarships for the conference, but I haven't heard if that's something we're going to be really doing this year again.
Oh, you got muted.
As I mentioned earlier, the business, we got to keep the lights on. We got to be able to pay for the company that's actually going to be hosting the conference. So something for it, unfortunately. It's funny, we just had an exercise where we were asked if NAAF had like unlimited resources, what would you like to see us do? And one of the things I put was just make the conference free. Everyone who wants to, just everyone is comped fully. But we're miles from that. We're not quite there yet. Maybe if we ever get like Bill Gates to be a donor, we can do that.
It'd be amazing. All right, so we're closing. Judith, you're going to be our first one. I know you wanted to say something.
I know the question was asked about, how when you go in, how do you go about, whether to write a speech. I've never been one of those people that can write a speech, and I just flow organically. And, I've left the conference rooms where there's a few tears. And, I remember I was at Mickey Sherrill's office while I was on the Hill and, just sharing my story about, what life is like with lupus. And, I remember telling them, I was like, I'm like a singer with no song, referring to being a scientist and not being able to be in a lab because I'm a liability due to, low hand dexterity, can't hold on to a pipette like I should. And, those things, how, it has affected my life daily. So I feel like, when you flow organically, you touch them more than, putting a speech together. But everybody's different on how they choose to tell their story or communicate with their legislators when they go see them. Yeah, so I just wanted to, add that because I remember George talking about the tears, and I've had a few that also made me emotional to, share my story. Yeah.
Thank you for sharing that. Tanush, I see you.
So I just wanted to touch on one of the questions asked earlier for someone who's not as extroverted who wants to be a part of this advocacy. So my first time going in to talk to a staffer was my freshman year. And that was my first time ever, you know, sharing my story or anything. And I didn't really know what to expect or anything. And it turns out, like, you know, the guy, he was roughly like 25, and he was just like really chill. And what I realized is, you know, those people, they're looking to help you, you know, they're not the bad guys. They're, you know, they're going to understand everything you're going to say, and they'll be very understanding. And at the end of the day, they're people as well, and they'll feel like sympathy for you. And that's important to think about.
Thank you, Tanush. And then I'll have you go ahead and start us off. One piece of advice you would give to those who are listening who want to get involved with this type of advocacy?
Well, number one, contact Gary, his email. but yeah, just know it's for a good cause at the end of the day, you know, in your community.
Wonderful. Christine, I see you next. One piece of advice for those who are listening.
Sure. I think one of the things that I've really appreciated about this experience is that it gives me an opportunity to not only talk about alopecia, but about autoimmune diseases in general, and to feel like I'm part of something greater and also really impactful, because we know that autoimmune diseases affect women more than they do men. And so there are a lot of, not that they don't affect men, but there's a large community of us who need support. And if it's alopecia, if it's lupus, if it's rheumatoid arthritis, there are so many different people who are affected by autoimmune diseases. And, you know, politicians are politicians, they're not scientists. And so it's really important for them to hear those messages as well, because I think they think in numbers. Phil can speak to this and Gary can speak to this. They think in numbers and reach. And NIAM's funding, you know, will reach lots of people, even if it's not specifically targeted at alopecia. Xeljanz is a drug that was created for rheumatoid arthritis, and they've discovered that it's helpful for people with alopecia. So, I mean, you get the sense that you're making a big impact, even just by talking about one specific disease.
Great. Ms. Ebony?
Yes, as Christine mentioned, it is a beautiful thing to be a part of something greater. When I first came into this organization, I had no idea what to expect. But once you begin opening up about your experiences and being more comfortable speaking with legislators, not only is that a healing process, but you get to allow yourself to just to let them see you. So make sure that you show up whenever you have these meetings, and just making sure that you are 100% yourself.
Definitely. Abby?
Yeah, I would echo what Tanush was saying too. You know, I've been on both sides of these meetings, many meetings. So I think remembering that these are people too, and, you know, our disease is relatable to a lot of people. Like you'll be surprised how many people will say that they knew someone who had alopecia, or, you know, had a family member. So I think remembering that, like, they are people and they'll most likely be really nice to you. And you may end up like touching them in a different way that you didn't expect, you know, that they have a cousin or a mother or something with alopecia too.
Thank you, Abby. Ms. Judith?
What I would say is for anyone that's watching this, that's, you know, going through the motions, self-acceptance and loving yourself is key to living a fulfilling life, you know, because alopecia is definitely not a death sentence. And you can definitely get through it and overcome it. Yeah.
Thank you for sharing that. There's actually research showing that advocating for yourself with a chronic condition can lead to improving one's wellness and mental health state. And so that's really important for myself and Dr. Renee and for everyone on this call as well. Mr. George.
Okay. Thanks. I would say from a parent being like a father's point of view to, and if your child has alopecia, at first you run around crazy and you try to solve the world. And that's what I was doing. And I think looking back at it, it would have been, and I'm getting much better at it. Just let the process kind of flow. Let your daughter, your son, when they're feeling more comfortable. So don't rush it, but I think, you know, you should be active. I think if you're a parent being, you know, involved, so your child can kind of see that, you know, there is options, there are people like you all that, I think that makes a big difference. So I would just not push your child, but get involved and let them see you do this, you know, and see you be an advocate. And then they start feeling more comfortable. And I think that's been helpful for me, for our family. And last thing, can you still hear me?
Yes.
When you go into the meetings with any of your senators or legislative people, I definitely think researching who you're going to meet with and looking at their bio, making connections with what university they went to, if they were in a fraternity, any connection like that really does break the ice if you're not comfortable talking right away. And it's such a small world, before you know it, you know, your dad grew up on the block with their father and played stickball together. So I've had crazy stories already with everyone that I've met, some connection. So it's, I think doing a little research, finding out who you're meeting with and their helps. And that's it.
Wonderful. Thanks, George. Mr. Phil, any advice for the group?
Just thank you all for your continued participation and your advocacy. I can't plug or stress it enough, you know, to get involved. You don't have to be an expert on the policy. You don't have to memorize the million and one acronyms that, you know, we use to describe different federal agencies. You don't have to memorize specifics of the bill. The one area that you're an expert in that's the most important is what your journey has been and your story. And that's what really makes a difference here in Washington and locally when you meet with offices. You know, you have Gary, you have myself, who we, you know, we put all these materials together that has all of the specific information. You know, communication is critical. We always ask folks to let us know how any conversation or meeting goes with who they've met with. And, you know, I can't tell you how many times somebody has said they wanted to learn more. And then I follow up with them, and that's how we develop, you know, offices into champions. So don't worry about the specifics. As was said, you know, you are the expert in your experience and your story. And that's what, you know, means the most to these members of Congress. My job on a daily basis is to make sure that they're following up on the policy's perspective of it. But, you know, you sharing your experience really is monumental. So thank you all for being willing to do that. I encourage you to reach out to Gary, reach out to myself, and I look forward to seeing many of you here in DC next year.
Thank you so much. And I'm going to give everyone a chance to go ahead, if you feel comfortable, to type in your contact in the chat at this point. So your email or Facebook or Instagram or Twitter or whatever you want to type into the chat for those to jot down. Gary, I'll let you have the last word, and then I'll give a few announcements for Let's Talk.
All right. Thank you, Angela. Well, first off, I want to underscore that, you know, remember that your legislators, your congresspeople, your senators, they work for you. They need your vote to keep their jobs. And they like their jobs. They want to keep their jobs. So that means they want to do whatever they can to help you whenever possible. It's their job to listen to you. And it doesn't necessarily mean that they're always going to do what you ask. They can't do that. They can't support every bit of legislation that comes across their desk. They've only got so much of a bandwidth. But the more you make them aware of an issue, the more likely they are to understand it. And the greater they understand something, the greater the likelihood is that they want to help. When Angela and Renee approached me to do this webinar, I was excited because I think this is a very worthwhile topic for a webinar, but then came the hard part. And that was choosing from over 300 legislative liaisons and mentors, just six of you to be on this call. So you know, I said, well, I've got lots to choose from, but if we can really only have six, here's who I recommend. And luckily you all made the time to take the time to, you know, be on this call and to all provide such incredible information and to share your own stories and your outlooks and your advice. And you guys are all fantastic. We could not have this success without you. And it's, you know, it's not just NAAF you're helping, obviously, it's 6.9 million Americans that you're representing when you go into those meetings. So thanks everyone, really appreciate it. And thank you, Angela and Renee, for giving us this opportunity.
Definitely.
So thank you guys.
Thank you. Just a couple of announcements. Again, this episode will be recorded and posted on the NAAF YouTube page, as well as the NAAF Let's Talk webpage. Our next Let's Talk episode is going to be May 20th, which is a Thursday from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. And it's going to be on clinical trials. We have a wonderful dermatologist from UC Davis who's going to be talking about clinical trials, what they are, how to get involved, the different types of them, specifically for the alopecia community. So that'll be a really great episode. I can't thank everyone who was a panelist tonight for your time and your candidness and just sharing your personal stories and giving advice to those in the group who really want to be an advocate for themselves and for our greater community. And so we're so happy that you were on this webinar episode. And if anyone didn't have a chance to jot down an email, you can always email info@naaf.org. To ask for contact information as well and to get a hold of Gary too. So thank you so much. That's all I have tonight. Dr. Renee, anything else?
Nope. Thank you guys. I really appreciate everything tonight. It was a wonderful episode.
Great. Great. Have a wonderful night.
Night,
thank you
guys.
Everyone.
Thank you
so
much. Everybody.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you. Good night.
Night.
Good night, everyone.
Bye.